In the Atelier is an offshoot of the award-winning literary publishing house Atelier 26 Books, which brings you brilliantly unconventional novels, short story collections, poetry, and a bit of nonfiction from contemporary authors. Check out our titles and order any at a discount at atelier26books.com. Hi, this is M. Allen Cunningham. I'm an author, publisher, and teacher in Portland, Oregon, and you're in the Atelier. In the Atelier is a place for occasional thoughts on literature, writing, the life of the imagination. Come on in. I'm glad you're here. Today's installment, What Would Leonard Do?
I'd love to speak with Leonard. He's a sportsman and a shepherd. He's a lazy bastard living in a suit. But he does say what I tell him, even though it isn't welcome. He just doesn't have the freedom to refuse. He will speak these words of wisdom like a sage, a man of vision, though he knows he's really nothing.
Not everyone could appreciate Leonard Cohen's performance style, but few ever questioned his chops as a songwriter. Demonstrated in immortal, frequently covered tunes like Bird on a Wire, Suzanne, and that holy exemplar for pop singers everywhere, Hallelujah. Wait, Leonard Cohen wrote that? You bet your muse he did.
Now I've heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord, but you don't really care for music. Do you? It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Leonard Cohen died at age 82 back in 2016. But I still speak of him mostly in the present tense. That's because, to my mind, Leonard remains the definition of soulful cool. As a perpetually idiosyncratic, authentic, prolific, creative spirit who was always intent on making his work the best it could be, and yet who endured a chronic lack of real commercial success, he's a total inspiration.
I was always working steady, but I never called it art. I got my shit together, meeting Christ and reading Marx. It failed my little fire, but it spread the dying spark. Go tell the young Messiah. What happens to the heart?
I've been listening to Leonard's music for more than 20 years, and it still inspires me. But even more inspiring than any single song among his countless masterful songs is the spirit of the man himself. It's a spirit exemplifying a kind of lyrical fearlessness. See the words to his songs, Is This What You Wanted, and Field Commander Cohen, and Democracy, just to get the beginning of a sense of what I'm talking about.
What happens to the heart?
And combined with Leonard's poetic fearlessness is his commitment to a species of deep focus that is, yes, monastic in its devotion. A focus that is among the most profoundly countercultural acts a person can undertake. It's the contemplative focus of a monk, sure, but also the focus of an imaginative practitioner. somebody endlessly honing their art.
I'm slowing down the tune. I never liked it fast. You want to get there soon. I want to get there last. It's not because I'm old. It's not the life I led. I always liked it slow. That's what my mama said. I'm lacing up my shoe, but I don't want to run. I'll get there when I do. Don't need no starting gun. It's not because I'm old.
Recently, I was talking with an old friend, a writer and filmmaker, who shares my regard for Cohen's work, and he and I both blurted out in unison, all but spontaneously, a phrase that captures Cohen's effect on both of us creatively. What would Leonard do? If you're an imaginative practitioner yourself, a dedicated, hardworking, creative soul, striving amidst and bewildered by the socially optimized, promo-driven spirit of our times, striving to continue doing the work of the expressive imagination, striving to honor an authentic vision that resists the forces of market optimization, you could do a lot worse than immerse yourself in Cohen's corpus and give that question your consideration. What would Leonard do? This man's long and meandering career is a lesson in resilience, constant reinvention, and ever-deepening craftsmanship. What would Leonard do? Let's look at some of the major moments in Leonard's life and work. Exhibit A. An accomplished poet and novelist, Leonard didn't set foot into popular music till age 33, with the 1967 release Songs of Leonard Cohen.
Come over to the window, my little darling. I'd like to try to read your poem. I used to think I was some kind of gypsy boy before I let you take me home. Now so long, Marianne.
By the time he released that first album, Leonard had already lived another life as a published writer, with multiple volumes of poetry and two novels to his credit. The written word was, and remain, Leonard's primo amore. The beauty of his songs owes to this fact, coupled with his remarkable way with melody. And as a novelist, Leonard is the real thing. This is quickly evident to readers of his 1963 debut novel, The Favorite Game. That book bristles with little beauties like the following. Just listen to the line-by-line construction here. This is a writer who cares about the rhythm and sound and precise meaning of every sentence. Quote, 7 to 11 is a huge chunk of life, full of dulling and forgetting. It is fabled that we slowly lose the gift of speech with animals, that birds no longer visit our window sills to converse. As our eyes grow accustomed to sight, they armor themselves against wonder. Flowers once the size of pine trees return to clay pots. Even terror diminishes. The giants and giantesses of the nursery shrink to crabby teachers and human fathers. Unquote. As idiosyncratic in his lyricism on the page as he would later be in his vocal style as a singer-songwriter, Leonard's work seemed to confuse the critics. Even in those novel-writing early days, they didn't quite know what to do with him. But Leonard wasn't about to submit to short-sighted critical pronouncements. Here he is at barely 30, right after the release of that debut novel, The Favorite Game, sticking up for himself on CBC Television.
Well, then, you've heard one person's opinion about your book. Do you think this is something you had to get off your chest, as the review said?
Yes, I think it was something I had to get off my chest, but not in the sense that I was taking off a hair shirt. You know, it wasn't the kind of thing I just discarded because I wanted to be able to go to bed easier at night. No, I wrote that, and it's really a third novel disguised as a first novel, and all the reviewers, as to be expected, fell for it. Because in Canada, people really can't accept the fact that anything good comes out of their neighbor's house. This is a particular Canadian failing. I'm not saying that this is good. I think it's good, but I'm not trying to be evangelical about it. I mean, the kind of reviewing, the attitude of the reviewers is a kind of head-patting review. You know, this is very good. This is his first novel. But in America, where they don't know that I'm a poet, they don't know it's my first novel, they don't know anything about it except it's a book between hard covers, the reviews have been much more objective and much less patronizing. It's a third novel, I promise you, future generations of readers and PhD students. It's a third novel disguised as a first novel, and it's very highly crafted and very highly disciplined, and everything I want to say is there. It's not just that first fine, careless frenzy.
Well, now, the man who you depict as your hero, Breveman, in the book...
A miserable guy.
I wondered about that. I was going to ask you whether you really could identify with him, whether you thought he was a strong character or a terribly weak one.
I think he's an honest person. I think the things that happened to him, the obscenities involved with God, the women he went to bed with, the people he hurt, the people he wanted to love, the things he saw, are the things that happened to everybody. And the people who have criticized the book for obscenity or for a kind of disgusting exposure are people who have not looked honestly into their own lives and who want to read about things which are not true.
Well, thank you very much, Leonard Cohen. It's been a pleasure to have you on the show. And all of us, including all our viewers, will of course keep an eye on your career. It's been a pleasure having
you. Thank
you
very much.
I couldn't make a living, said Leonard later on, looking back at why he left the writing life for music. I admire the resiliency, adaptability, or call it existential good faith it must require to surrender one's idea of oneself and one's career without despair after years of hard work. And I admire the resourcefulness and creativity with which Leonard applied his great gifts in a different field. He never abandoned poetry at all, as his incomparable lyrics everywhere attest. In a 1968 interview, he was humble about his transitional nature. Quote, "Everybody I meet wipes me out. Here are all these people plugging away at their roles, being producers and policemen and bishops. It knocks me out. I don't even think of myself as a writer, singer, or whatever. The occupation of being a man is so much more." Unquote. But 2 years earlier, in his second novel, Beautiful Losers, he'd written the following lines. To me, they seem a perfect bit of Cohen's self-description. Quote, "It is a kind of balance that is his glory. He rides the drifts like an escaped ski. His course is a caress of the hill. Something in him so loves the world that he gives himself to laws of gravity and chance." Unquote. What would Leonard do? Exhibit B. Leonard was always his own self and always did his own thing, take it or leave it. He's been frequently compared to Bob Dylan in that both singers are not exactly what their industry refers to as natural talents. But Leonard's thing, because it's so completely and self-revealingly unique, becomes at its best irresistibly stylish and graceful and, yes, breathtakingly beautiful. Just listen to his flat, effortless, endlessly alluring croon on the song Famous Blue Raincoat. Goodness me.
It's 4 in the morning, the end of December. I'm writing you now just to see if you're better. New York is cold, but I like where I'm living. There's music on Clinton Street all through the evening. I hear that you're building your little house deep in the desert. You're living for nothing now. I hope you're keeping some kind of record. Yes, and Jane came by.
What would Leonard do? Exhibit C. Back in the 1990s, Leonard fled the endless enticements of prospective fame and wealth to live for 5 years submitting to the ascetic rigors at a Zen monastery in the rugged, sun-baked, snow-caked terrain of Southern California's Mount Baldy. Enough said. What would Leonard do? Exhibit D. Beginning at age 78, Leonard undertook a world tour that lasted 16 months. By the time it was over, he had played 125 shows, pretty much without a break, many of them involving multiple encores and stretching to nearly 3 hours. I had the good fortune to attend one of those concerts here in Portland. At the end of nearly every concert, including the one I attended, this 78-year-old literally skipped off stage. There's a kind of otherworldly vivacity in all of this. What would Leonard do? Exhibit E. Leonard continued writing and recording right up until his death. He made his 14th and final album, entitled You Want It Darker, in the Spartan living room of his Los Angeles home, propped up in an orthopedic chair to sing, despite intense pain, which included multiple fractures of his spine. You Want It Darker came out 3 weeks before he died. Here's the music of a man walking unwaveringly toward death and singing all the way.
If you are the dealer, I'm out of the game. If you are the healer, means I'm broken and lame. If thine is the glory, then mine must be the shame. You want it darker. We kill the flame. Magnified, sanctified be thy holy name. Vilified, crucified in the human frame. A million candles burning for the help that never came. You want it darker. Hey, nay, 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 nay. I'm ready, my lord.
What would Leonard do? Exhibit F. In perfect Leonard Cohen form, he surprised the world, even from beyond the grave, with a 15th album entitled Thanks for the Dance. This masterful posthumous work was assembled from a handful of vocal recordings Leonard had made during those sessions for You Want It Darker. Leonard's son, Adam, and a host of collaborators, including Leslie Feist, Beck, and Damien Rice, completed the instrumentation for the album's 9 gem-like songs, giving us a last masterpiece that does much more than honor Leonard's memory. Beyond letting us hear, for one final time, new poetry and melodies from Leonard Cohen, these songs render Leonard the great troubadour in all his soulful presence.
Thanks for the dance. I'm sorry you're tired. The evening hardly begun. Thanks for the dance. Try to look inspired. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1.
There's a thanks for the dance. No. Your shoulders. Thank you, Leonard.
There. You've been wearing this costume forever. So turn up the music, pour out the wine, stop at the surface is fine.
In the Atelier is produced by Atelier 26 Books. For more information, visit atelier26books.com. I'm M. Alan Cunningham. Thanks for listening. So long for now.
They sentence me to 20 years of boredom. Trying to change the system from within. I'm coming now, I'm coming to reward them. First, we take Manhattan. Then we take